Thank you very much, my friend. We are following this as well. U.S. House and Senate leaders, as Stuart pointed out, have cobbled together, in principle, the details of a tax package they hope to get ready for a vote maybe early next week, signed by the president. The week after that, that, of course, would be Christmas week. Let's talk to Scott Martin and Charlie Gasparino and Kat Timp. Kat, what do you think?
They have to get it done before Doug Jones gets in there. It's not going to happen because Corker, we know, is a no for sure.
Right.
And Susan Collins, if they take away these health care concessions, which they very well may, she's going to be a no, and then it's no go. So,
by the way, she might be a no if they've
regardless,
done anything to adjust
absolutely,
the top rate,
right? Absolutely. Right. So I know it's Christmas time and everyone's in the little holiday, ho ho, holly jolly spirit, but they need to buckle down and get to work if they want to have any hope of getting it done.
Scott, how do you think it looks?
I just got in the spirit. Thanks to you for saying that. You know, I think you made a good point, Neil. I think you assume Collins is no either way. And that's what makes this really dangerous about Christmas time being a deadline because, my goodness, like you said, with Congress not really maybe wanting to work as hard around the holidays. Now, here's the weirdest thing to me, Neil. Remember when you talked to Steve Mnuchin, I don't know, back in early March, I think it was, and we were promised this was going to be done by August. Then it was done by Thanksgiving. Now we're running up against Christmas. I mean, what's next? Easter? I mean, we're missing all these deadlines. Nothing against the Easter Bunny, because he may actually be able to kick this one in, and maybe with a vote or two. But we're running against all these deadlines and blowing them. And it's getting so complicated.
Schumer's this frantic and frenetic pace. And to Kat's point, maybe given the election in Alabama and to try to avoid, you know, the Democratic candidate coming in and changing things, they're going to work with the 52-48 majority they have for the time being, right?
Yeah, and, you know, I think they're rushing it through. I think it's a lousy tax plan on the individual side.
Totally.
I mean, there is nothing Reagan-esque about the individual tax cut.
Well, they're
trying
to do things to satisfy you and your
how much it's going to add to the deficit
They literally are screwing over Republican House members in New York, New Jersey, California.
So this tinkering around you've seen is not...
It's not enough because this salt thing is going to kill Peter King.
Yep.
I mean, listen, ask Peter, talk to Peter. Peter does not represent a bunch of, you know, multi-gazillionaire hedge fund managers. He represents people, you know, better than working class from in the Midwest, but in New York, you're solidly middle class if you make $200,000 a year, and they're
so
going
no matter
get
what, he's still
to pay
gonna
for
be,
a massive
he's still
tax
be a no
cut.
Vote.
I think so. You got to ask him. I mean, maybe they're twisting his arm to figure out. But, you know, here's the thing. Can Republicans maintain their majority in the House if they lose every Republican in those blue states?
It's going to be impossible.
I don't know how.
And here's the other thing. Remember the talk about the pass-through treatment? And this is a handout, like Charlie said, to big business. And the biggest ones, because the pass-throughs, Neil, depending on how you're classified, you may not get the break.
Right.
Depending on if you're classified as a personal service business or not. Right. That was another thing that was talked about early on, Charlie and Kat, was this was going to be a handout, or not a handout, but at least some help to small businesses. Not so fast. In Illinois, we have a lot of pass-throughs that are not going to get benefits because
of
the way they're classified.
I think that a lot of people are looking at it as just a political win at this point. The Obamacare repeal didn't happen. There's no wall that happened, and I wasn't a fan of the wall, but they need a political win.
But it's going to, who knows what the price is going to be.
Right.
Let's be real clear here. They are lying about that, about the private equity thing.
Oh, the carried interest.
The carried interest. The president keeps saying, I don't know who tells him to say this, we will make sure that hedge fund managers cannot benefit from the carried interest deduction, which is a huge tax break, not for hedge fund managers, for private equity managers. Hedge fund managers don't get touched by this. And they're,
right,
and they're
you're
keeping
getting,
this
You're knee-deep in the weeds. You're a brilliant guy.
You know what it is?
But I
it's a tax break for the rich.
Okay, but I want to just get the big picture, guy, because one of the things we're hearing in the proposal that was sort of shot out today is this 21% corporate rate, a 37% top individual rate, a middle ground on the mortgage deduction, state local taxes up to $750,000 now there versus $1 million the way it was before, $500,000 at its lows. Trying to find some middle ground here, but not raising the overall $10,000 cap here. So what they seem to be saying, since a disproportionate number of people who are stuck with this high state local taxes are paying at the top rate, they're going to give them the benefit of a lower rate, which will net them a tax cut. Do you believe that?
I don't know what I believe anymore. I mean, like you said, we keep hearing that it's going to happen. This isn't a perfect bill. I don't love the bill, especially because it's supposed to add billions, if not trillions, to the deficit. And as a younger person, that's going to fall on me if it doesn't pay for itself. But I think that because of the rush and because of Doug Jones, A lot of people are going to try to push it through, even if they don't believe it themselves, just because they want the short-term political win.
As a young person, I've heard young people complain about that. Your generation whines a great deal about it. But I'm kidding. But part of the rationale for that is that we don't like the taxes because they don't seem to be paid for. But you haven't said anything about the $9 trillion in added spending that's going to be added.
We have to cut spending. Okay. I'm conservative that way. I think that if we're going to add to the deficit, we need to actually do some cutting of spending.
On whether tax cuts are paid, which is fine, and then ignoring the something that is nine times bigger, the spending that's going to be added to that debt.
Cutting spending is very politically tough to do, but right. I would love to see it happen. And I think that's why people vote for Republicans. It's because they do want to see cut spending. They do want to see tax cuts.
Clear. President Trump ran not touching any entitlements.
Right.
And by the way, it's not just spending. It's really the entitlements, right, that add to the future deficit and
problems. He's held out the possibility of welfare reform, that kind of thing. Yeah. That's a next year development. You have your doubts.
I don't see it happening. Can't get a tax cut through. Goodness. And that was something that's, remember, this was supposedly bipartisan. Infrastructure, you mentioned this earlier, Kat, about other things that have
not
happened.
Well, that's coming too.
Yeah. Infrastructure coming spending was supposed to be the easy one. It's December.
I'm glad they didn't do that one. That is a boondoggle.
Totally.
That would have been insane. That's actually more spending. Obama tried it. Remember on this network?
Right.
You know, it's funny listening to people on this network say how great infrastructure spending is. Not you, but others. And all of a sudden,
I didn't understand what it was.
But when Obama wanted to do it, it wasn't so great.
Yeah. This is this network was going nuts on the Obama Recovery Act.
Yeah.
It's the same thing on the left, too, because a lot of people on the left who supported it when Obama did it are now saying they don't just because it's Trump's idea.
Yeah.
So it's both sides that are doing it.
Well, I guess the thinking with the infrastructure, we have to get the taxes. They are firmly convinced they have, by the way, the votes to get this done. I don't know where they're getting it, but they're convinced of that. I'll give them the benefit of the doubt they get it done. But then the next battle would be infrastructure that could get more Democratic support, or so they hope. Do you see that happening?
I think that there are a lot of Democrats that are reluctant to support anything that President Trump does just because President Trump did it. I think that that's a lot of spending.
Would they turn their back on something? I mean, this is in the DNA of a lot of Democrats.
It
goes back to FDR.
It absolutely is, but then we'll have a lot of problem with Republicans. Everything is very, very divided right now. I personally, infrastructure spending is not what I'm concerned about. I'd like to see cutting spending.
I don't know how they're going to do an infrastructure bill when they are so myopically focused on the static nature of this tax cut. Paul Ryan just basically concedes that, listen, tax cuts don't pay for themselves. I mean, that's why we're having this debate. And then he's going to go out and do infrastructure spending. It seems like, I don't know how Republicans are going to bring themselves if they're so worried about tax cuts not paying for themselves. Do infrastructure
So these guys
spending,
who, because they heard you on our air constantly criticizing
Yes.
And they have lowered the top rate another couple of points for you,
and by the way, Susan Collins, who I love.
Right. But they've lowered it. You're still saying not good enough.
I don't think
you're a tough negotiator.
I don't think so. I believe in real
tax. What does Charlie Gasparino want? 35% top rate?
I believe that Ronald Reagan, if he were the president today, would have spent a year pushing Congress to take the top rate down to 30%. And selling not a static tax plan, but a
which
real
would have
tax
been
plan.
Higher than when he left office.
Yeah. Very
left
true. And it would have been simpler, though. That's the other thing, too. We talked about simplifying the brackets. We're still going to be as complicated as ever.
But I mean,
remember the single index card and all
but
that.
But let's be real clear. Yeah. This is a downside of a president that is not really intellectually connected to legislation or anything
else. You're being very nasty.
And
that
I think
true.
Point
what has he done?
Doesn't realize how divided the party is anyway. That's the other problem you mentioned with infrastructure. It's no guarantee that the Republicans are going to go with it. Anyway, you may have more Democrats.
Right, so it's not going to be Democrats plus Republicans.
Orrin Hatch is on the wires right now. The Senate Finance Committee had the chief Senate negotiator. I think it's fair to say he's the chief guy. He's confident that this is going to all pass.
It's probably going to pass, but it's still going to be lousy.
It's going to be a political push.
The markets will like it. 22%, 21% corporate tax rate.
All right, net.
I'm going to go buy some Apple.
Really? Okay. All right. We have a lot more coming up here, including the latest right now on the markets reacting to this. They are still in and out of the highs of the day, largely on optimism that this process is moving. To Charlie's point and some of my other guests' point, they might not love all the details, but that they seem to be thinking that this is better than what we've got right now.